I'd like to welcome Ria Mae to the Stumble Forward. Ria is an East Coast Music Award-winning, Juno Award-nominated singer-songwriter. I first discovered Ria Mae hearing Close Off in high rotation on the radio around 2015. The single sounded fresh and decidedly not Canadian, by my reckoning. When it was revealed that Ria was an independent artist from Halifax, I was completely sold. I'm excited to be able to talk with her today. Please welcome Ria Mae. Ria Mae's here.
Hello.
So, how are you?
I'm good. Thanks for that nice intro.
Well, it's my pleasure. It's true, though. So, look, can we go back to Close Off? You were truly an independent artist. You did that song and you promoted it with your own money, your own energy. How did that all happen?
Yes. So, I was very independent. I couldn't get a manager to work with me or an agent or definitely not a label. Yeah, wrote this song, Close Off. My whole goal was to get on radio. Like, you know, since I was a kid, I just wanted to be on pop radio. And I reached out to Classified, who is a hip hop artist that also lives in Halifax. And I was like, okay, he's the guy from here that, you know, made it out. And he produced it for me. And then, yeah, I sort of had to make this choice between recording a few more songs or taking that one to radio. And I just had a gut feeling. I was like, I'm just going to go with it. So I put it to radio. It didn't really get the pop stations until Sony got involved.
Right.
But I put it out and it got some ads on alternative stations in Ottawa, Newfoundland, Halifax. And then someone from Sony heard it. And then they sort of like took it down, put it back up. And yeah, it was cool.
But in that story to me, you know, the subtext is courageous person with enormous self-belief attempts to make their way into an industry that is a perpetual uphill climb. Like, it's indicative of somebody who had the stuff, quote unquote. Like, did you know that? Did you know you were sort of borrowing from a deep well of courage? And like, cause, I mean, the crazy thing about the music business is, we all apparently have this dream, but it's kind of like it's elusive because what is the dream really? Like you don't really understand what you're asking for until you're kind of in the middle of it. At least that's what I found in music.
Yeah, it's so funny that I didn't really have confidence anywhere else in my life, but I remember sitting down. I remember feeling so desperate's not the right word, but I was like in disbelief at one point. Like no one wanted to work with me here. And I was like selling out, you know, 120 cap little venues, and I felt like I had fans and I felt like my music was good. And I remember starting to be worried, because instead of being like, I'm just wondering if you'd listen to music, I started being like, this album's going to do very well and I really need someone to help me. Like that's how I started talking to people. And then I was like, am I like this narcissist, like insane person? Like, yeah. So I just remember having that energy and saying like, I listen to pop music all the time and I would totally listen to this. And I'm like being, you know, going over every part of the arrangement. Yeah, no, it comes in at this amount of time that like, what am I missing? And Classified was the only one that really gave me that like, man, this is good. And yeah, thankfully he was there and Sony ended up calling him. They didn't even know how to reach me. I was very, very so independent. I didn't have a contact.
So hold it a second here. I'm getting glimpses into the process of writing Close Off that there was some calculation involved in wanting to make something popular. Yeah. I mean, of course, for quote unquote artists, like this is, you know, admitting such a thing would be admitting that, you know, your very foundations are phony. I mean, I don't feel that way at all. I sort of feel like there's a lot of goals you can have when you're going into a process of writing and trying to write something that's going to be popular is certainly as honorable and you know, as honorable an approach as any. So tell me about that calculation. You even just said like you even mathematically were cognizant of the fact that what choruses had to come in at a certain time, hooks had to be a certain length. Like what were you actually dealing with mathematically on that?
Well, I think it's like as opposed to trying to like find a calculation for something that could be popular, to me it was just like, how do I keep the attention so they're not going to look, you know, turn the station, look away. Like, I need the attention. And so for me, it's just every moment in a song, I'm working on new music now. It's the same thing. I go for a walk, I come back, I listen. And if there's a moment that I'm getting bored or just I'm like, hey, something's wrong. It's not good enough until the entire song, anyone can sit down and listen to it, start to finish, and they're not just going to start talking to their friend midway. That's, you know, I don't know for sure, but that's the calculation I'm trying to do in my head. And yeah, it is not the popular thing to do. And Halifax, has such a great scene of like alternative music and singer-songwriter and folk and people that would really roll their eyes at pop music and trying to be, yeah, like popular. So it wasn't, I remember feeling like secretive and like a little bit embarrassed about wanting that. But I just kept comparing it to like a TV writer or other kinds of art where you're really trying to focus on every 4-second increment and be like, is it good enough? And, you know, to me, that's the fun of it. It's like doing a crossword puzzle or, you know, that's, I love that part of it.
Yeah. You know, you're speaking right to me. I mean, it's the process of writing to me is like a craft, you know, and it's a beautiful piece of, it's an opportunity to work towards some kind of divine symmetry. Like it's an opportunity to work towards some kind of divine perfection in a way. Like that pop song, when it starts to come together is thrilling. Like when your internal organs are starting to resonate with how this thing is mathematically becoming more succinct with every moment you're sort of spending with it. It's thrilling.
It's the best. That moment when an idea comes and then you're like, oh, like, I don't know how you, I write a lot on logic, and a lot of it is just, I don't feel like I can write with my brain. I've always felt this. Like, if I sit there and try to write a song with you, I don't think I'm going to impress anybody. Like, I feel like it all comes from this subconscious. And so, yeah, I'll sit down and sometimes an idea will come out and I go, whoa. And I'm trying to like, okay, thank God I recorded it. What was that? Okay, is that a chorus? And the moment when I feel like I go, okay, that is definitely a pre-chorus and this is the chorus. That moment is the funnest moment. I mean, by the time I get to the end 15%, I hate it. Like, I hate what I'm doing right now with my music, which is like, I think it's done. Fuck, I need a vocal. I've been congested for 6 weeks. Ugh, you know, like that part sucks. But like the moment where you think you have it, there's nothing still that's better than that moment for me.
I feel you so deeply on this. And to speak to your, like, the last 15% being the least fun, like, I feel like I had to write a contract with myself about 10 or 15 years ago, which was a confirmation that I would finish everything I started for the most part as a gift to myself. I also thought for a lot of my early career that I could put a half-baked idea into the world, expecting that the audience would be able to fill in the blanks, you know, like, oh no, the chorus is here. It's just mostly here. I'll just get it out. Cause you know, people will figure it out, but really it is your job to fulfill the vision completely. It took me a while. At least that's my feeling. Do you have that sense as well?
It's interesting. The first thing I think of is like, I used to assume that everyone had songwriter brain.
Yeah.
Where you hear something and you can, you're drawing the rest in, easy peasy, but not everyone has it. And I think I learned that around the time I was putting clothes off. Like, I used to send demo. I did it recently and got embarrassed myself. Like, I show someone, what do you think about this demo? And it's like, I listen back a few months later, I'm like, I sent that out.
Yeah,
I'm hearing it fully finished exactly. And I'm like, oh, they're not hearing that. They're hearing like ding, 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 like this, like, I'm like, oh God, I didn't even tune the vocal. What am I doing? Like,
I know.
Yeah.
Even back when I was signed to a label, I remember feeling like I had written a big hit and was talking to somebody at the label, said, oh, send it over. You know, this was back when I would have had to have couriered a CDR in the mail or like, you know, and it was reluctant. I was like, I don't know. I think I should finish it. And this person at the label was like, trust me, I can hear through the demo. It was like, okay. So I sent it off and then I got a response back. There was too much bass. And I was like, I thought
too
you
much, yeah, you're
demo.
Listening to the bass. Do not listen to the bass.
I thought you could see the demo.
Yeah, that's it's, thank God for those. I had this great A&R at Sony, Joe Ferrari, who
he's wonderful.
I think you're his all-time favorite artist.
Well, I think he's a lovely guy.
He's so great. He was so good, and my manager Terry as well. Like, I could send them those little snippets, like, and I like an idea on my phone, and whoa, what's that? Finish that.
So but he could hear that stuff.
He could hear it, but I've worked with other people since where I thought, you know, some people can hear things, but not your things. So I've sent it before to other people since then. I'm like, I'm not doing that again.
Why do we think that other people have that songwriting mind that they can finish the song for us? Like, is it a devaluation of the process? Is it just a sense that everybody contains creativity and could take a half-finished idea and finish it themselves? Like, why would we assume that? It seems strange now that we're talking about it. It seems weird to me.
I think it's just so natural for some people. You know, like if...
Well, it's natural for you.
If there was like a bucket of chalk, I'm thinking of my kids play out here, and there was like a line and then a space and a line, and you said, connect those lines with this chalk, you'd be like, of course. You assume everyone could do that. That's what it feels like to me. I'm like, well, yeah, this incredible chorus and the chords are already there. Of course I can write a verse.
Yeah.
Come on. Everyone can write a verse. But yeah, then it's like my dad is so good for that, being like, how are you composing? So wait, he can't even wrap his mind around the fact, like, he knows that I didn't study music, and he's like, I don't understand how you're doing it. And I'm like, I don't understand how you're not doing it.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know. It's like such a weird...
And of course, like, it almost sounds like we're putting in people's faces here, just like by having a conversation in this capacity. But when you out yourself as somebody who, you know, we've both just said, like, there's just an assumption that what we do effectively boils down to, it's just not really that special, that anybody could do it.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'll just put something half baked together and you can finish it on your own whenever you get the time. You can listen to it and you can come up with your own verse. Because like you, if I have a hot chorus just right there in the pocket, like, the verse is a cinch. It's like, well, this, we just got to... I always see the chorus as like the punchline. You just got to write the joke. It's easy.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. Yeah. If you have the hook, if you have the thing that's catchy, then everything else is just easy.
But your instinct for that with Close Off must have been pretty succinct. Because, I mean, like I said, that didn't sound Canadian to me. That sounded like uber confident, uber clever. And not only that, the texture of your singing voice is so beautiful, so unique, so wonderful. Like, I don't know how you feel, but like in pop music now, for female artists, there's a lot of that sort of baby marble mouth voice, and everybody has it. And it's like, why do you all want to sing like this? Like, it's weird to me that people aren't seeking an individuality, that everybody's happy to have that voice. And for the audience, they're happy to hear artist after artist after artist sing like that. Yet you come along with Close Off. It's not just an incredible piece of mathematical pop writing, but there's this voice to it that sounds bloody eternal to me. It sounds like this person's voice comes from that eternal stream. And all of a sudden it lends even deeper credibility to the Close Off thing. Cause it's like, even the texture of the voice is eternally believable to me. I mean, did you know that? Do you know you have one of those voices?
No, it's so funny. I'm like, I could bask in you talking about this forever. No, I don't know. I'm constantly being like, what was it? Like, what? It's funny. My wife always points that out on the radio. Like, there's something about
the
way
marble mouth.
Females are. But I don't pick up on it as much because I'm focused. But yeah, I don't know. And if anything, I think since that confident few years, I'm like, oh, am I singing too loud? Everyone's singing really quiet. No, I don't know. I have no idea. I think I benefited from always being, I've never fit in with one of the girls. So I don't think I even look at, I'm like, oh, should I be doing that? If anything, I'm like, what's Hawksley doing? Always wearing hats? Okay, maybe I'll wear a hat. Like, you know, like I've never had that thing where so maybe I almost think I'm trying to, you know, we're all trying to be cool in our way. And I'm like, I think I'm trying to be something that I just physically and my voice, it will never be. So I'm landing in a place that's unique, but it's not on purpose. Yeah. I think it's just a bit of luck of like, you know, my voice is lower. I don't know. I have no idea, but.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of it, like you just sort of said, is the magic is in what you get. Like, is you let the human, you know, mechanism do its thing. And, you know, we're wildly individual if left to our own devices a lot of time. Like, I guess it just felt to me like the Close Off thing was fully formed. And I think that as somebody who works a lot of young artists, like when I hear something that approaches fully formed from somebody who I've never heard of, it's like exciting to me. Cause I'm like, well, how did they get on that journey to this place where they just contain a lot of wisdom? Like, it can come from, like you said, like studied knowledge, or you can just be sort of an organism who's kind of, whose filter is set up to kind of operate within this context. I feel like you're probably the second, at least that's what you're sort of, you're telling me.
It's funny, that topic, there's nothing that is more, maybe heartbreaking is too dramatic, but when I see a young artist and they have the first or second song come out, that's so incredible. And you have this feeling, and then they start like co-writing with the people that are already doing it. Cause of course they're like, oh, I want to be, and then their music just goes on. We all have that thing of, oh, but if I'm just, they'll see I'm more pop. I could be even more rap. I could be, and they start going on this path that's actually losing the thing that everyone liked about them. And it's so hard to know. I've seen that probably 8 or 9 times in the last 5 years where I reach out to an artist and I'm like, oh my God, like this, what you're doing is incredible. And then the next one is like the same as everyone else. And I'm like, oh. And I've been guilty of that too. I feel like there's definitely, I don't want to name the songs, but I've put out songs, even ones that have done okay, like on radio, that I'm like, I was doing that thing a little bit.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, you know, you guys think I'm like this alt artist. Well, I can be really pop. It's like my ego. And then a couple months go by and I'm like, that shirt didn't fit, right? Like, yeah. I'm embarrassed of that haircut.
Yeah.
So I do it too, but luckily I think I didn't do it. That first album was sort of, you know, it had several songs that were, it was, the album was done when Sony signed me, and I think I benefited from that. I never had to do the co-writing,
yeah,
anything like that until the next album.
Yeah, that co-writing thing's crazy. Like, and I get it, and I love doing it, yeah. And I understand what it is we're shooting for. You know, I feel like I listened to some interviews of yours, and there's something that came up a few times that's consistent with, you know, I feel like is one of my current conundrums is that I was a people pleaser for a lot of years, and it worked really well when I was a kid in school and getting good marks. And I think it was a good way to play inside the system for a while. And then when you get into the big game of music, you realize that authenticity piece is the biggest piece.
Yeah.
And for a people pleaser, we'll toss out the authenticity piece in favor of doing something sometimes that we think more people will like. And in just what you said, we hear a lot of artists do that. So we know that this people pleaser conundrum is not just yours and mine. I think it's a stumbling block for a lot of people. I think also, too, I think, you know, from what I can tell from Twitter and stuff, like, we want our artists to be nice and kind and all this stuff. But sometimes you have to be a jerk, and sometimes you have to be difficult. And I think sometimes to do something great means you're not going to be able to please people. Like, I'm not going to be able to smile at my teacher and get a good mark. Like, to make an artistic statement that's authentic is going to, you're going to bristle somebody. Do you think?
Yes. And I've 100% been a people pleaser. And I think I'm interested to know if you felt this too, doing the radio rounds and publicity. I was getting high on the fact that my label would be like, wow, you work harder than any other. Most artists do not like doing these things. And I'm like, let's get a bunch of donuts for C106. Let's do, like, you know, I'm there. And I felt my mentality wasn't that I was an artist. My mentality was that I worked for Sony and I was their best employee, you know? And I got off on that's a big part of my personality.
So heavy.
And it's, and I think it worked really well. But yeah, then transitioning back to being, I'm in a mode finally, and thank God for my wife, Sarah. She really sees me in ways that I can't. And I've been working on this new album that reminds me, not musically, of that first Sony album, but it's completely mine. I'm not co-writing. It's just mine. I'm working in this little cave and the little cave next door that I've painted black. So I have two different vibes. And I'm just turning, like, you know, I'm getting things coming in, you know, Juno's is coming up in my hometown, and there's probably 5-6 shows that I got offered. And I can't, cause that's people pleaser, Ria. Like, I'm an entertainer. I grew up with my dad in the restaurant business. My shows, I give everything. I meet everybody. I love doing that. That's so important to me. But songwriter Ria is not that. And I can't make, if I want to make a proper album that is authentic to me, I need the world to shut off. I need to be selfish. I need to leave my kids at 8 in the morning. And I need to do, what I've been doing the last 5 months. Yeah, but I've only realized that recently, like through probably therapy and Sarah this year. So it's interesting that you ask that, but I can't do both. I'm trying to take advantage of the fact that I'm really good with people, and I really value everyone that buys a ticket. Like, if you buy a ticket for, I don't even know how much my tickets are. I don't know, but mm-hmm. I value that, and I put on the best show I can, and I go to the merch table and everything. But that is me wanting other people to be happy, you know? And I can't, I think a really mentally healthy person could do both at the same time, and I can't. I have to separate those seasons.
I've been on this podcast discussing a lot about even just the Canadian-ness of that people-pleasing thing. Mm. I've heard you speak a lot about your ability to sort of envision your ideal future and move into it, although I feel like I've, in my sort of spiritual world these last year and a half, I feel like I've been on a major rebuild where I look at my career and realize that I never made an open statement to the universe that I wanted something, mm-hmm. that my goal was this or that. I was just a talented kid who kind of like bounced from one opportunity offered to me to the next, but never with a mind that I had a vision where I was, you know, trying to be famous or trying to, and I feel like in some ways it's my Canadian-ness that I never would have wanted to out myself to my cohort yeah. on Queen Street yeah. that I was hoping to play the game at a very high level and win because yeah. as Canadians we're quite put off by that. But I yeah. feel like in some ways I may have missed out on my spiritual duty to serve myself in that way. And in some ways this, the people pleaser narrative is in this piece as well.
Yeah.
Is this making sense?
Totally. I think about that a lot. And the Canadian-ness and the Nova Scotian-ness for me, I'm like,
right.
double whammy. There's yeah. like that tall poppy syndrome.
Oh yeah.
There's, you know, I don't have my plaques and stuff up in my rooms. I don't want the, yeah, but I wonder if it's a, and I don't wonder, I bet it's a disservice. I see other, and some Canadians are getting really good at it too, just people that hold themselves and say, I've done, they come online just to tell you something they've done that's great. And when I see it, I'm never like, oh my God, I roll. Yeah. I'm always like, wow, that's incredible you did that. But then if I do it, I'm like, oh my God, who am I to like just make a post about something I did? Like, I can't, yeah, I don't know. I'm like, is it my upbringing? Was it my Canadian? I don't know. But certainly when I meet artists in the States, they don't have that thing. And I'm jealous.
Yeah. I am too. And it's kind of new, I think, in a way. I think that it's, for me, it's arriving in midlife for a real deep accounting of what I've done, how I've done it, and mm-hmm. where I'm going. And this is one of those big pieces that's really flashing in my face. Mm. I was interviewing Kathleen Edwards the other day, and I was saying, like, you know, you, what about giving advice to young artists? Because I feel like right now, again, in my big spiritual rebuild, I'm wishing that there had been a wise, gentle so-and-so to come to the 28-year-old version of me to say, hey, the 20 things that you're most worried about are ridiculous, and here's mm. the 20 things that somebody really should be worried about.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's insane. And, you know, in this experience that we're in, where, you know, it's moored to a linear timeline, and, you know, we have a sense that I come from somewhere and I'm going to somewhere. But, what's my question? I guess my question is, are you giving advice? And are you, people must be asking, because you're a representation of success. So people must be coming to you and asking for advice. Are you giving advice? Are you I felt like I was about to give a lot of advice. I started to give some advice. Mm-hmm. I feel like it was destructive fundamentally. It's like you're giving advice to somebody out of step of that, the narrative of their natural timeline, maybe, you know, like right. maybe we do stumble towards the stuff we're supposed to learn in our own time.
Yeah.
But that doesn't preclude me wanting to say, hey, trust me, a major left turn is what's required here. Do you have any thoughts on this?
I do, especially because I moved back to Halifax a couple years ago. I was living in Toronto. And so now there's a lot of young artists here that will reach out. And yeah, I don't know. It's I never give advice that's like, revisit that song, bud. You know, like I try to be really kind with it, but you can't really give advice. There's one or two kids here that remind me of me, where they're taking everything and they're kind of bold with their, like, I'm going to do well. And so I'm kind of there whenever they need, like, you know, how does this work? But in terms of overall advice, yeah, I don't know, because everyone's journey is so different and the music industry changes so much. I remember people giving advice when I started, like, all you have to do is tour Canada 2 or 3 times. And by the 4th time, you'll be headlining. And I remember being like, that's not going to work for me right now. Like, touring was just getting expensive. I had been on the road a bunch. It wasn't really working. I was like, nah, I need to get on radio. Like, I need to get on. And I knew it was just, I knew not to take that advice. So if I had just taken their advice, it would have ruined my path.
Mm.
But I don't know. It's hard. It's, yeah. I feel like some people don't need advice and some people take too much advice. I don't know. No one knows the answer.
Yeah. And it is an elusive, like, just when I think I'm figuring out that there's a roadmap that I could say is absolute to how you do this job. Like, it's so incumbent on every moment leading into every next moment. Like, there are days where I feel within the zeitgeist that my stock is up, and there are days where I can just wake up and go and sort of whiff in the air. Oh yeah, my stock's down. Like, I'm, you know, whether it's just a, you know, I can just sense that there's more people interested or there's just less. And like, you know, sometimes the zeitgeist is very interested in what you have. And sometimes it feels like you're kind of making music for no good reason. And those seasons, I've not been able to ascertain if those are things that I could control if I was that much more spiritual or that much more connected to something authentic. You know, I think that, but the bumps and bruises aspect and the Sisyphean aspect of pushing a rock up a hill every day, like, you know, it's our choice. And I'm so grateful for the freedom that my life offers me, but there's certainly no lack of like opportunity for humiliation. At least that was a word I used to use. I try to use it less. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I keep thinking, I have a lot of ups and downs with, oh, I have an audience that's waiting for new music, or I have like, maybe my time's done because the last 2 years with my new baby have been all consuming. And, you know, I'm taking my damn time trying to figure myself out to be a better person and parent. And now it's translating to being more authentic in my music. But I wonder, I'm telling myself now that when I have those moments of dips where I don't believe in myself, I'm like, okay, that's just my mental, that's just mental. Like, if I was someone who ran every day, like my brother does, and I was constantly in that like really great headspace, I know I'd feel like amazing about my music career, about everything. So I think I'm pretty good at telling myself that when I'm in a low and just being like, oh God, you know, when the rock feels extra heavy to push up the hill, I'm like, okay, don't think about your career today. Go do something else.
Mm.
Yeah, I don't know. I try to tell myself that it's a lie. If I have those, I don't know if that's what you were talking about, but that's where I am right now, because there's days and weeks. I lived in Australia last year for a few months. My in-laws live there. And the weather is beautiful every day. I went to the gym every day because they were taking care of the kids. And every day I came back and was on top of the world. And all these great things came to me because of it. And now I'm in Nova Scotia in the winter. It's one of the worst places to be in the winter. And it's the best place to be in the summer. So I have to tell myself, like, I'm not going to feel like I have a bunch of people waiting on my music right now. I'm going to feel the opposite, that can't influence that I'm still making music every day instead of, you know, doing a job. It's so stressful too. Like, I'm supporting my family and they just see me come in this room every day. I think my wife's like, fuck, fingers crossed, there's something happening in there. Because, you know, like, enough times have gone by that I'm like, all right, I should really be putting some stuff out, but I'm just trying to trust the journey and not trust the negative. But I don't know.
I'm a dog fanatic, and so much so, and I don't have a dog. So sometimes if I'm visiting a friend or I'm in a store that has a dog in it or whatever, if there's a strange dog, I impose myself to the degree where even my giddy want for that dog to like me turns the dog off. And I feel like that giddy want, when you're dealing with the universe and trying to manifest a music career, the universe looks at that same giddy want for for the dog to love you, that the universe goes, no, like we reward those who don't care.
I was just thinking about this yesterday and talking about it yesterday.
Okay, so let's hear what you're thinking.
The magnet that you can create to repel things and to bring it forward.
Huge.
So before my Sony deal, I would say a year before, there was people in Halifax I was so jealous of, whose music careers, and now when I look back, I've probably surpassed, if you were able to, I don't know.
Yeah, measure it.
If you were to measure it in some way, which you really can't. But I was so jealous, I had to like unfollow friends on Facebook. Like I said before, I couldn't get a manager. My energy was like wanting so much that everyone was a bit repelled, like it wasn't obvious like that, but just it was energy. And I remember being like, okay, I have to go the other way. I would see people that were just so chill and things would come to them. And I really think that's why the Sony thing happened, was I did delete all those people I was jealous of, even though they're wonderful people. I was like, I can't see them every day. That's not helping. Mm. And I just started, trying to make my energy. And I had to remind myself lately, I'm doing that again. And I swear to you, it's been since about mid-December. And things are rolling in. I keep telling Sarah, I'm like, Sarah, I forgot to tell you, I got this email, this DM, this, like, and I'm just doing it because I know I'm about to start releasing new music. So I need to get on that same wavelength. But I'm saying no to things. I'm saying no to things. And the more I do, they're coming in because I'm sort of saying no to things that aren't serving the bigger purpose that I feel like the universe knows that I want, and I'm funneling it towards me. That's how I think about it. And I was, just speaking about this yesterday, that it's already working. Like, I need reminders. I don't remember all the time. I haven't remembered for like 2 years before this, but it's a real thing to me.
It is a real thing. I mean, again, I think there are people who are designed to know that. And then people like you and I who have to keep reminding ourselves literally after we've taken 2 years and we've forgotten.
Yeah,
I liken it. And anybody who's listening regularly to the podcast probably getting tired of me talking about how I feel like I obsessively studied cool people because I'm not a cool person. Mm. And people who around me who are like, oh, no, you're cool. No, look at what you do. Like, you're cool. I'm like, no. I'm talking scientific. Like, I know who's cool. And I feel like you're born that way or you're born earnest. And I feel like in some ways you were born earnest and I was born earnest. And earnest people, we're never going to be cool. Like it's an unfortunate thing. And I feel like I'm battling my earnestness. Even when I was signed to Universal, like you said earlier, like I was Universal's favorite little workhorse. Like, boy, Workman he'll do everything. Like he'll show up. Doesn't matter what time he's doing Canada AM. He's there at 3:30 doing a sound check, whatever.
Yeah.
And then I would see assholes getting further than me within the context. Cause I was like, well, but what about the asshole who won't do this stuff? It seems like they got a charting song right now. Like where's my charting song? You know, like, and again, this is in the postlude of counting all my chickens after they've hatched as a 49-year-old person going, okay, I'd really like to learn something here. Mm-hmm. Like, cause I'm in a weird job where I've trusted myself. I've trusted my instincts. I've gone very deep on this. I have a sort of a somewhat elaborate inner architecture to, that holds the thing that I am up. Why is this conundrum still a conundrum? Is it bigger than it used to be? Is it smaller than it used to be? But does any of this resonate with you?
It all resonates with me. It's funny because I've seen someone, and I don't know if we're exactly the same, but if you and I are one thing and then there's people that don't care at all. I was lucky enough to spend a bunch of time with an artist who was even more on the extreme, putting you and I in the middle. And I saw it like, oh, shoot, like this guy is ass kissing, actually.
Right.
And in a way that was like, he was trying to get a job with everybody almost, it seemed like. And I was like, oh, it was very, I was like, okay, that's a reminder of what I can be like a little bit. Like, let's try to, it's funny, but the big thing I'm thinking of as you say that is, what a blessing to be still so fascinated and grappling with things in your head that way, because that is what an artist, if you didn't have that, you wouldn't be touring and writing music. You'd be like, I'm bored, I'm gonna go. I feel like the thing, I was saying this to my wife the other day, there's so much going on with, you know, just trying to deal with my upbringing, and, you know, just for me, being a parent has brought up so much stuff that I now have to deal with. And I'm like, I wonder if a lot of people at this age don't feel, I still feel like I'm a teenager trying to figure out life. And I feel like that's why I'm writing. Like, otherwise it would be too boring for me to just go and write. But I'm literally being like, how do I feel? Why do I feel? Oh, fuck, that's how I feel. And I don't know that a lot of people at this stage in life do that. So I think it's maybe a gift to be always figuring out how you can better be in the world. But yeah, I don't know. I definitely do the same thing where I look back and I'm like, man, I didn't need to do this, or I went down this path too long, or some of my resentments I have are like, why did I listen to this person?
Yeah, me too.
And then I'm like mad at that person, and I'm like, it's not their fault. I listened to them.
It was always you.
Everyone listens. 10,000 people could have given me advice. I chose this person because for some reason I'm insecure around that person, or I just trusted them. And they were very wrong. And it's like, that's not their fault. But yeah.
The interviews I've heard you give are all very spiritually astute, in my opinion. Again, like, you're younger than me, but I feel like you've got something in you that has something ancient going on, because you are wrestling with these bigger pieces. I always liken it to, like, I think we're lucky, we could say that we have these jobs where we have to maintain a relationship with our self-examination. And I always talk about it with my wife, like, that we're just two people who like to have the hood up on the car. Like, we're always tinkering with the engine, because it's like neither one of us are ever completely satisfied where we land spiritually. We can be digging. And then one revelation about yourself can also reveal 10 new potential directions to search in, you know, and uncover. You know, it's quite an endless. And of course, talking about it out loud like this could be misconstrued as narcissism. I don't think it really is. I think that this artistic pursuit that we're on is a self-examination pursuit. Do you think?
Yeah. And I mean, I think about, narcissism all the time. I was certainly around it when I was a kid. So I think about it a lot, and I think about how nice it would be to not just be looking in all the time. This is like the topic of all my new music. but I think I've always felt like, even though I've not fit in, like I said, I've never looked like the other girls. For some reason, I've had this sense that what I feel is exactly what every other human would feel if they were in my position. I've never thought that my brain and my feelings are different. Like, I've never been embarrassed about. And so when I latch onto something new, a new topic that I feel like is the truth, I'm like, oh, this is everyone who's been through this is going to be like happy that I've found this little truth. You know, they could find another truth, a novelist could find, but like this little one, there's going to be people that listen and go, oh fuck, that's how I feel. Cause you know, that's what I did when I wrote it. So I hope it's definitely a very self-involved art, but it's, I always have that little thing of like, oh, someone's going to like this. Someone's going to need this. So I think that evens it out for me, but.
Is that because you're a fan of music? Like, I feel like I got into the business in a way because I was a fan. I wanted to make something that I would be geeked to pull off the shelf and put in the CD player. That was part of my want.
Yeah.
Like, you're a fan, right?
Yeah, I'm a big fan. I'm putting together this show in Halifax. We're just thinking about putting it together. And yeah, I'm just trying to be like, what would I want to go to? Like, if Jan Arden was going to release a new album right now, and it could be in any venue that I get to choose and the format I got to choose it. Yeah. It's like, what would I want? Okay. I'd want to have a glass of red wine. I'd want it to be kind of early. I'd want the sound to be great. I'd want her to do 60% talking and a bit of behind the scenes, you know, like, what would I want? And that's how I flip it. And yeah, I'm a big music fan. Absolutely. Like, when I was on the radio, I was listening to the radio nonstop. Like, when people are like, oh, pop music, they change the station. I'm like, I listen, I know every writer on every song. I was a fan.
Yeah.
The only people that liked music more than me were probably the people that worked for the label. I was like, oh, they like it way more than me.
It's funny, all of the songwriter people in my life, from my cohort, I even just think of Ron Sexsmith just off the top of my head because I interviewed him a couple weeks ago, is a music fanatic and is a songwriter fanatic and a songwriting fanatic. And I feel the same. Like, I go deep like you do. Like, who made this? Yeah. Who's responsible? I want to know the process. I'm very fascinated by who stumbled in the general direction of the light to come up with this incredible thing that we're all still using all the same notes. Like, they didn't make any more notes. Like, you know, we're all more or less writing songs within a tempo, you know, range that's pretty much the same. Yet somehow, when you do come up with that thing that has a clear infusion of magic, again, it's like, whoa, here we are. Like, I'm being overtaken by the gift, and the process becomes that gift as well. Like, I've had to indulge more in the process. I feel like in order to serve the process better, I've had to respect it more. You know, I've had to prioritize the process as, hey, there's good stuff happening here. It's not just about the high five when it's done, you know? Who are you signed with now? Are you on a label? You're working towards, you're independent right now?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm independent. It's a scary place to be, but I want to release more music and not care about if it's the perfect radio song. I want to challenge myself to write it. I write Monday to Friday in the mornings, and I usually just turn on some music or instrumental, and I just get, it's like a journal, like I don't journal, so I just get things out, and usually it's just like just humming, and sometimes it's like a line or two of truth, and sometimes a little song will come of that would never be on the radio in a zillion years, but luckily we're in this time that's not really a thing anymore. So I want to challenge myself to releasing more of those and just sort of being more, I don't know, to me it's like being more of an artist, like not saying this is the perfect song and I'll release one every 4 months. I'm like, no, let's do every 6 weeks for a bit. I got a bunch of them. Yeah. So
it's funny because the word content creator has sort of stood in for the word artist, and the word content is standing in for the word art. And I mean, I don't want to feel highfalutin and everything. I'm just a pop writer at the end of the day, but it does feel like I'm engaged with some esoteric art by doing it. And I can't just flush the whole idea that what I'm doing is not important. But it does sort of feel like the culture is telling me, hey, get in line. You're just a content creator making content. Mm-hmm. And in my heart, that's not true. You know, in my heart, I'm making something that's going to shake the earth. Every time I go into the studio, that's what I'm trying to do. And I feel like, you know, you and I wrote one time a few years ago, but I feel like you have that essence about you too, that the opportunity to write is never a throwaway. It's always an opportunity to transcend. I know you and I are in that studio, and that song kind of never went anywhere, but I think we were both trying to transcend. And that's an exciting, if not honorable, thing to be attempting to do. Would you not agree?
Yeah. What was the first part of that?
I don't know. I was just babbling. talking about, it was something to
content.
Do with
content. Yeah. Content,
the content
creation.
Sorry. That's
versus...
right. Thanks for being my brains for me.
First of all, this era of, you know, TikTok and having to release content all the time, I really have pulled back because the people pleaser me or whatever. It's like, I did it for a while on TikTok. Like, you know, I can look at a trend. I'm smart enough to know how to tell a story. So I can do a 12-second thing that gets a bunch of views. I was in Dubai a couple years ago and did a bunch of stuff on Dubai versus Canada. And then I got home to Canada and I was like, I can do this, but then I'm just buying myself a job doing this. And I don't actually like this. It doesn't feel like me. It feels like I'm trying to be good at the thing that the kids are. I've dialed it back, and now I'm, you know, I don't do Twitter. I don't look at YouTube, even though my label hated that. I'm going to come back and do more content, quote unquote, in my own way, just more music and more, you know, conversations like this. My bandmate and I, Chris, have been talking about that for a while. But do it in my own way, because you can't just, it's like the everyone's voice sounding the same on radio. Like if you do the same, you know, you get those challenges, TikTok challenges, and the way people are on Instagram, your own algorithm is feeding you the same type of person. And then if you just become that type of person, you can't win that game, and you don't want to win that game. And it's a full-time job. I don't want that full-time job. And there's so many avenues for, you know, there's so many avenues for if you're thinking about making money in your career, you know, that's one of them, but there's other ones too. Releasing often on Spotify gives you money if you own the masters. Having a touring career will give you money. So if you're just trying to make money, for me, releasing on social media all the time is not filling my heart. There's other things I could do for money. I could go back to construction management. So I'm trying to, be really honest with myself of what parts of music do I love and can't live without doing, and which ones am I okay with leaving money on the table, you know?
So huge. It feels like you're 10 or 15 years ahead of me.
This is all very new. The last couple of months have been wild in my head. I've had a bunch of breakthroughs, but I also dabbled in A&R for a bit last year. I worked with an incredible label called Network, and I was signing artists for them all over the world. And I was trying hard to quit music. I was like, this is kind of like music, and it's less emotional for me. And I love helping young people, and I love finding new music and sending them to Terry McBride. My whole life has been that. Terry, listen to this. But I don't think I realized how important the writing every day and the sacred space of, I don't know what day of the week it is. I don't know what time of day it is. And, you know, it was good for me to say like, okay, I actually don't love that part. I love the writing part. And I'm still just figuring it out.
So how did that happen? It's so weird that you would do that, but I
Everyone
understand it
that.
Completely. Like, I feel like I'm always sort of, I've got a couple of friends who I've met through the gym who are kind of, you know, I'm like, oh, wouldn't it be great to like work at their store? Like, wouldn't it be great to like just be somebody who didn't do this? Like,
I know, I get so jealous. I honestly get so jealous. My younger sister works with my dad in real estate, and I'm like, that'd be so fun if I could, especially just like, yeah, it'd be so fun to not have this, not that it's a burden, but it's kind of a burden. It's a lot of stress. There's a lot for all the amazing things. There's equal parts like burden. I would love to go. Yeah. For me, I think going to Network was like, wouldn't it be great to go to a job?
Yeah.
You know, you're going to get paid.
Yeah.
And I'm also working in music, and I feel so like normal. And when someone asks me what I do, I say, well, I work at a label. I don't have to say, oh, well, and all those things that my ego just really wanted to love that job. And I did, but my soul freaked out. Songs were spilling out of me on Zoom meetings. I'd be like, there'd be 40 people on a meeting, and then I'd be like, mute it, and I'd be like, a song would come out about like being insecure around normal people that have normal jobs. And yeah,
but in a way it's succinct. Like, I feel like what I love about touring is that I enter into a single day contract with that town, with that promoter, with those people. We all set up, the circus comes, we set up the tent. The cotton candy gets put out in the lobby.
Yeah.
I do the show. Everybody goes, hurrah. We close it all down. They write me a check, and it's done. And it feels very satisfying how the circle can be completed in one go like that.
Yeah.
Or so much of the rest of our lives are, write a song. Do they like it? Will they like it? Is it going to get played? Oh, the radio guy thinks he might be able to get played. He's got some nibbles out there in the West or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, is it going to get, and then you're waiting for that circle to close. And I feel like a long music career is a long life of circles that never get closed. And so I start to long for closing a circle. Just give me something that has a narrative with a beginning and a middle and an end that I can, once that book is done, I put it on the shelf and it's over. It just feels like a long music career is a lot of open books sitting out on the coffee table. And now they're spilling it onto the floor. And now they're spilling out of the room. And now they're spilling out of the house onto the driveway. And now they're spilling out into the street. It's like, just give me a thing where at the end of the day, everybody goes, hey, great job. And it's over.
Yeah, I love how music can feel like you're running a small business.
Yeah.
Like even if I was just selling like washers and dryers, like if to me, music feels like that because I'm like, okay, I'm looking down the line. I'm like, okay, well, let's see. When will we run out of money? Okay, let's book a couple shows. Oh, we're going to do really good. I'll work extra hard at promoting them. Get your check. There, we're good. And you get to be in control. It feels like there's elements where you get to be in control as if you're going to, yeah, like promote your new washer and dryer and sell it to everyone in your community.
It is a small business. I mean, mine's a small business. Yeah. I watched my grandma, who had a hair salon in her house, run a cash business out of her house. My mom had a hair salon in our house. Like, I saw two women like who had decided they could work for themselves from their own homes and like make a go of it. So, I mean, both my brother and I are independent business owners too. For that reason, I think it's like it was just the image was there. It looked totally succinct, and I could jump on very easily. You grew up in the restaurant biz. Is that what you said?
Yeah, I've never seen my parents have real jobs. Yeah, my dad ran restaurants. Then he just sold the restaurant and started doing real estate. My mom was mostly stay at home, but she had her own like counseling business for a bit. So like, yeah, I've never seen. To me, it's not. I have friends that have very normal jobs. Like I was out with them last night, nurses and. You know, regular jobs. And like for they're like, so wait, you do Monday to Friday. What do you do Monday to Friday? I'm like, well, I walk 12 steps in my backyard and I sit in this room and I, you know, come up with ideas. Like it sounds insane, you know, and I feel like bad saying it. I'm like, yeah, like I've made a lot of intentional choices to have this freedom, but it sounds like, you know, most people couldn't handle being like, well, I'm going to try to write an album over the next 7 months and hopefully it does okay so that I can pay my mortgage in 2026. Like the long tail of it is so different than most people, you know, think of making money. It's just like a different, it's interesting.
Do you feel like you use your freedom wisely?
I've never thought about that before. I think I forget that not everybody has, no, I don't think I use it wisely.
Yeah.
I'm trying to use it more wisely. Like we don't need to live, my wife's a stay at home. And I'm a musician. We could live in Timbuktu. And we often forget that. No, I'm a little bit trapped in my own self.
Yeah. That's a big one. I've been looking at, poking at my freedom because I know it's the thing I love the most about what I do. It's the thing I'm most afraid to lose. Whenever I sit back and have one of those like artistic days of like, artists worrying about the future, mm-hmm. which happened less and less, but still happened.
Yeah.
The biggest thing is that, what if I lost my freedom? Then there are days where I fucking fritter away an entire free day. Like I have lots of them.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, same.
And it's like, shit, how did that happen? Where I'm so cavalier about this now. It's the thing that I tell myself I love the most about what I do. It's the thing I would be the most sad to lose. Yet, I can still take a day and waste it like anybody else.
Yeah, I waste a lot of days. And I also, I used to do this thing where I thought, so let's say I have like 4 days doing, you know, I have to go to the grocery store and take the kids. And then I know I have my 4 days to write starting. Like I didn't used to do Monday to Friday. And I always thought I needed the first day to kind of like putter and clean, listen to music, and I'm doing all this stuff. It's taken me like a day and a half to get into the zone. And this year I realized that like by just having a habit of coming in around 8, it takes me like 10 seconds to get into the zone now. I don't have to do all that. But at the same time, yeah, I'm great at wasting time, but I wonder if that's the art. Like I wonder if that's part of it sometimes.
Yeah.
Like I'm constantly looking for, am I feeling the thing that I feel when I write? No. Right now I'm like, am I feeling like I can sing yet? No. My nostrils blocked. Okay.
Yeah.
So what can I, you know, you're just constantly being like, how do I feel? What's the best kind of day for how I feel?
Yeah.
I can't really do anything. So let me do some like physical, let me paint the floor that I've been meaning to do. Like, but yeah, it's a lot of it's wasting.
It's I am-ness though too. Like when I consider my spiritual, like what I'm considering these days spiritually, it's like just filling up every minute with productivity doesn't necessarily, that kind of flies in the face of just being, you know, and maybe wasted time is just being through the lens of our 21st century where we're supposed to be side hustling and making every moment count and, you know, writing a check for every, you know, every second supposed to result in a payday or something.
Right.
And I mean, maybe artists are supposed to waste time, quote unquote. Maybe it's the wrong word, but it's the right image of maybe every day isn't active. Maybe part of being an artist is a passive act.
Yeah. And I think maybe I struggle with, if I'm having one of those days, I'll put on a podcast or I'll try to get something done to not feel the guilt of not doing something. But yeah, I think you're right. I think we all need time that's just probably silent or with our thoughts or just being okay with sitting on the couch. And I struggle with that because I do waste time, but it's the guilt from that is heavy. It's like, oh, I could have been way more. I could have been famous in, you know, Australia if it wasn't for these days that, you know, yeah. Every Friday is wasted on errands and, you know, meeting up with a friend and not doing anything. But I think it's also important. Yeah, I think the self-reflection, like that we were just talking about earlier, like I know I have a lot of friends with regular jobs that don't self-reflect in that way and they don't have the luxury of it. They have to get up, get their kids to school, go to their job. They come back. There's no time. They have the 1 or 2 days a week to do errands. There's no time to self-reflect. There's no, you know. So it's, I don't know what tangent I'm going on here, but self-reflection, good.
Self-reflection. Lastly, so you're working on a music. You're. Mm-hmm. I love that you have a writing practice, a 5 day a week. To me, this is like music to my ears. I think people are under the impression that artists sort of sit with a daisy in their teeth under a tree, waiting for inspiration to come find them. Whereas I'm more of a make inspiration. Like yeah. You have to make it, right?
Yeah.
This is an exciting thing to hear that you're somebody who's got a 5 day a week practice. That to me indicates like you're a serious customer. So what is the plan for this music? Like,
So this is also like when I started working with Classified, he was Monday to Thursday. He always did. He wouldn't work before 10 a.m. with an artist because he did family stuff, kid drop off, whatever. He would work. We would write music work on our songs from 10 to 2. He would then start smoking weed to get creative melody ideas around 2. And at 5:30, you had to leave his house. It was dinner time. And I was like, how could you? I never had a schedule. And maybe it's because of kids. But now that I have kids, I have this schedule and it's been really good for me. Because you can't just always rely, especially the older you get and you have more things to do, just there's things to do.
Yeah.
So it's like you have to really protect that space. It's really, really important and difficult. But yeah, since I've had this Monday to Friday situation, I've been writing the best music I've ever written.
I love it.
And I'm glad for all the co-writing I did because I've learned a lot of tricks, but I'm not inviting that into this project. So, yeah, I'm just doing the thing.
Well, Ria Mae, I'm a fan. I appreciate this chat very, very much. It was great to connect because I've been wondering what the heck a megatown like you's doing these days. So here we are. Now we know. We'll be looking out for you because we want to hear. We want to hear what you've got a twinkle that's so wonderful. It's nice to see you twinkling even across this Zoom page. And bless you and your family.
Well,
bless you in your songwriting process. And thank you so much for being so generous with your time. I appreciate it so much.
Yeah, thank you. I hope to run into you in real life soon. Let me know.
Real life?
Yeah, let me know when you're in Halifax. I've heard about it.
We're out in Halifax in a few weeks. Maybe we're playing a show at the Lighthouse or whatever. So if you're feeling like it.
I'd love to come to that show.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll be there. Cool.
Okay.
All right.
Bless you. Thanks so much.
All right. See ya.
Bye.
The Stumble Forward is an Isadora Media production and is hosted by Hawksley Workman and produced by Jennifer Cavanaugh. Be sure to subscribe and follow The Stumble Forward. You can support the podcast at patreon.com/Hawksley Workman. Thank you for listening.
Stumble Forward, Stumble Forward, The Stumble Forward.